Oops. On the clicker?
Yeah.
It is? Okay. And I'll create a group for get y'all on the
You guys have gone through Kate's workshop. I'll just kind of like review what she did, and like if there are any questions related to that, then I'll answer them. Like the first demo was the first workshop is very pretty basic. It's mostly just like populating and then doing some basic analysis. So let me.
There we
Oh yeah, that's what you're right. Thank you.
go.
So this is like just basic budgeting that she did. Going through basic like Excel, you have like you can populate, you have your items, you have different columns, and you can have numbers and text, and you can have different type of fields, like currency, and you can set different decimals. I think the one thing that is important are the formulas that you would want to know and how to build them. So let's say if you have here's some household items that you want to buy, right? And is it an item that is splurge or no? You can either set like yes and no manually, or you can also set yes and no conditions on the column. And that would allow you to, do a drop down and choose, but also you can, just do it manually. And if you have like that's like your quantity that you want to buy in like let's say in a month or a week. So what you're doing is you're doing a comparison between your store brand and name brand. And so if you have a name brand, it costs $30 and your store brand is $7.50. So you wanna calculate the difference per unit, right? So you can just put in the formula if you want to do that here. You can manually build the formula, which is like, you pick the cell and you want to find out the difference between name brand and our store brand price. And so you pick the name brand and you pick the store brand. You get the difference. You can also use the formula builder here. Which should difference. Sure. So you can build the formula like this, or you can manually type in the. I'm trying to see if there's like a formula for difference. It's not showing me. That's interesting. But yeah, so, and then you can drag and drop down the formula. So, you know, this was your formula and you want to drag and drop it down. So you just drop it down. Maybe I can just remove the numbers here.
To fall back to making that.
So you don't have to manually put it in for each column, for each row. So you can just drag and drop it down. And so now you want to find out, okay, so this is the difference per unit, but you also want to find out the difference per quantity, right? So here's your quantity and here's your difference per unit. So you multiply both these numbers. And so you can again build the formula. So multiplication sign is star. And similarly, you will just drag and drop it down. And so you can also do an average or total. So you want to do difference per unit. What is the difference per unit? Average difference per unit, right? So you can build the formula yourself. So you want to take the average of these values. So you can select the first value and then drag till whatever value you want to take the average to. And it will do give you average, or you can also build it yourself. So if you go here and statistical, you can find average. And so it will you can put in the you can put in the cell ranges that you want. So you can select these ranges. Oh, sorry, not these, sorry. I too. So you can select these ranges and it will go there and automatically pick it up. And you can even like put ranges from other cells. Like let's say there was another column that you wanted to take average from. Like I'm just giving an example. And so it would give you an average of all these both these two columns. That's something neat. And similarly, if you want to sum. So here I want to sum for difference all the quantity that if you know if I was spending, what would be the total sum? So again, you can build the formula. Sum or you can also build it using the functions here. Sum and then select the ranges and add it. I think there was something that I wanted to show you guys. Okay. And also you can do like sorting. So if you want to filter some records, like let's say So you need to apply the filter on the whole whole sheet. So what you can do is go to the first cell and press Control A, and it will select the whole populated range of tables, populated range of values, and then you can go here and select this at the top and say filter. So now it will give you this filter. And what this filter would allow you to do is, let's say if you want to just filter out the splurge items, or you want to filter in the non-splurge items, so you remove the yes, so it will remove the filter. And you can clear the filter from splurge, so it will go it back. Let's say here you want only produce items, so you can just say produce, and it will give you produce items. Yeah. So the thing that I wanted to show you was, let's say that you have these totals here at the bottom, right? So you had this total here. Right, which is $81.59, right, for the total. Now, if you are changing, let's say you are filtering out some values. So let's say you just want the produce values. You did that, and now it's automatically adjusted the total. And that happens if you use the subtotal function. If you don't use the subtotal function, then it's going to give you the sum of all the values even after you filter it. But when you use the subtotal, so you have to give it the function name, which is once you go to the subtotal here, the function name, let's actually show you. So here it is telling you what is the function name. So you want the sum, right? So that is function number 9, right? If you wanted average, then you would pick number 1. So that you'll do 9. And then you'll give it the range of the values. So originally we had I2 to I9, right? Because we had like a bunch of values. So I applied it on the original table. But it will see here that, okay, right now we are just having these three values. So it's going to build a subtotal of that. And it's not going to do it for the whole. But let's say if I put sum here, and did sum, it will give me the overall sum, right? Because I put it on the whole. I'll just show you again, like with the all. So this was our whole table. This was the total sum, right? And if I even after I let's say filter it, it's still, oh, there we go. Straight. So we had this sum, and if I'm going to come here and filter it, why is it doing that? You're automatically picking it up. But actually, let's do this. I don't know why it's doing that. It's filtering out us. For some reason, it's picking this as blank and then filtering out this uploader. But I don't know why what happened. But I just wanted to show you, like, if you do the subtotal, it's going to give you the total of whatever you're filtered out. So it's a good it's a good function if you're using it in the tables. So let's say if you're here and you want your table to look a little bit pretty, what you can do is you see here, like, I copy pasted it from the last table, and it's cutting this cutting the values here. So what you can do is you can come here, select all the table, and you can say format, and you can say auto fit column width, and it's going to auto fit to show all the names and everything, each column. So it will do it on its own. So that's a nice, neat way of, like, just presenting your table. So one thing that Kate did was, apply the if function. So what you can do is, you're trying to make a logical decision here. You're saying if your difference between the store brand and the name brand is less than $1, then you're going to buy the name brand. Otherwise, you will buy the store brand because, you don't want to spend so much money. So if you want to make that decision, so you can build the formula using the if function here, and it's kind of like intuitive. So you can say, what's the logical test? So the logical test is that is your difference less than one or not? So you're going to pick this cell here. And you're going to say, is this less than one or not? And you can say less than one, or you can even put less than or equal to one, where you would put the e is equal to sign after less than. So that would mean less than or equal to. But if you just say less, then it would mean less than. And you say, is it less than one? Right? If it's true, then you're going to buy the store brand. So it's going to give you the value of store brand. And if it's false, you're going to buy the name brand. So it's going to give you the value of sorry, if it's if it's true, you're going to buy name brand, and if it's false, you're going to buy store brand. Because if it's true, it's less than one, so you're going to buy the name brand, and if it's more, then you're going to buy the store brand. And you don't need to put the quotation marks; it will automatically pick it up. So in this case, you're buying store brand because the difference is $67. So you can just drag and drop. Actually, let's build the formula here by our own hand. So you can also manually build it. So first you give the logical test, which is this less than or equal to one? Then you put the comma. So every time there's a new input to the formula, you put a comma and give that input. Is this less than one? If it is less than one, then give me the value name brand. If not, and Excel will tell you how to, build the formula also. So it's telling you, okay, there are three inputs to this formula. First is the logical test, second is value if true, and third is value if false. And if it is false, then I will buy the store brand. And so you get the same thing. And you can drag and drop it down and also check. So in this case, there were two items which are less than one. There's 0.64 and 0.9, and it is giving name brand. So that's it. And finally, I think she also built that if you're buying the store brand, then give me the total cost of buying the store brand for a given quantity. And if I'm buying the name brand, then give me the total cost when I'm buying the name brand. So basically what it's doing is it's checking here if it's store brand, then it's multiplying the store brand price with quantity. And if it sees here that it's not store brand, then it means it's name brand. And then if it is name brand, then it's buying the name brand. Then it's multiplying the name brand quantity. So here what's happening is you can again So you can build the formula again here. Sorry. The other thing you can do is if you want to select all the values in the column, so you can go to the first cell and you can press Control Shift and down arrow. Sorry. Wherever there is a value, sorry. It's going to select all the values till there's no blank. So let's say if I fill it here, so it's going to select all the values till there's no blank. So it's going to select till three. So let's say if I put a value here, like let's say nine, right? If I'm going to select that, it's not going to go till nine because it recognizes a blank there. And so if you want to go till nine, you can press that again and it's going to go till nine. And it's going to do that. Keep doing that. So shift control and down arrow, or the other way around, shift control and up arrow, and it's going through that. So let's build that formula here. So we have if. So your logical test is this cell equal to store brand? So in this case, you also have to put in the quotation marks because now you are giving a formula as a condition. So you need to exactly give the condition. It's not going to pick the quotation marks. If it is true, then you multiply the store brand quantity, store brand price with the quantity. And if it is not true, then you are going to multiply the name brand quantity, the name brand price with the quantity. Oh. No. Name brand with the quantity. Right. So you can see here that in this case, we are buying store brand. So 7.5 into 3 is 22.5. And here we are buying name brand. So that should be 3.1 into quantity 1 instead of 2.46 into 1. So And if you want like the decimals, you can just push select this, and if you want it in currency, you can go here and you see there are this dollar sign. You can pick that, and it's also automatically going to give you the currency values. Right, so that was demo one. Let's go to the other one.
It's a metro bike.
Yeah, I was just wondering if she had the Excel also, because like I think it's the CSV, but it's fine. So what you can do is here, I think I downloaded it. Maybe I did it download. Yeah, okay. So we have this data in CSV format, which is a comma separated value. It's the most commonly used format, because all your data will mostly be published in CSV. Online data you'll find will be in CSV, and so it's a very common format. And if you open the file, it will open that in your Excel. And if you look at the file in text format, it's going to, you'll see a bunch of values with separated by commas. But the Excel, or if you're using Python or R, it's going to recognize the format and it's going to give you that format. So I wanted to see if we can import the data. You can bring it in two ways. You can just open the file, or you can, open a sheet and import data. So what I did here was, get data, and from file, and your is from a CSV. So this was your CSV file, and you would say import. And it would load the data. So here it's going to load in the table format already. Whereas in this case, this was not a table format. This is just your Excel sheet. So again, if you want to like format it, no, you want to format it as a table right now. Auto fit column width, the important thing here is that this is a very large table, right? And you want to do some analysis on this table, and you can. You can do a bunch of analysis here on the table, but since it's very large data, you want to get like some sort of like summary statistics, right? And for that, something that is very useful is pivot tables, and you're going to use it a lot if you know you're working on Excel professionally or on big projects. So if you go here, select all the data, which is Control A on the first cell, it will select all the data, and you're going to say pivot table, and from table range. So it has already selected that range, so you don't need to do it again. And you're going to say okay. So now it's going to put in that pivot table. And so now you can start doing some analysis on the. So now you can start doing some analysis on this pivot table. So let's say you want to find out checkout dates. What are the checkout dates in your whole data set, right? So these are all the checkout dates. It ranges from, fifth March to 19th March in your data set, right? And now, so you can just either select it, you can say checkout date, or you can drag and drop to rows here. And let's say within the date, you want to see what are the different times. So the other thing you can do is you can pick that checkout time and get it to rows here. So what it's going to do is it's going to begin build a hierarchy. So in rows, when you it's going to build a hierarchy. So your first was checkout date, and then your next was checkout time, right? Where did it go? Right. So for every date, it's going to give you the time from 12 a.m. to 12 a.m. to 12 a.m., right? And if you reverse the order, like let's say I put hours over checkout date, so what it's going to do is going to reverse it, right? It's going to say, okay, for 12 a.m., I'm going to have all the dates. Let's remove actually minutes from here and seconds. So, yeah. So it's going to say 12 a.m. for 12 a.m. all the dates. So I want to show you that this is how it builds the hierarchy, right? So you can always, build hierarchy like this. So let's say I put checkout date above, and now I want for all these times I just want to get a count of all the checkouts for each date and for each hour. So what I'll do is I'll go to the trip ID. I can pick up any column from here and put it in columns or put it in values. And I can say, okay, so in this case, it's giving me a sum of trip IDs. Well, trip IDs are random generated numbers, right? You don't want a sum of that because they don't mean anything. So what you can do is you can go to the value field settings, and you want a count of that. So it's just counting how many trip IDs there are, right? And that essentially means how many times the bikes have been checked out. So you do the count.
Trip IDs per day.
No, trip IDs every time you check out a bike,
Okay.
right? But here are we are now clustering it per day and per hour, right? Yeah. So now it's going so per day on 5th March, 13 or 4 trips were done, 13 or 4 times the bikes were checked out. And a breakdown of that is, okay, so at 12 a.m., sorry, at 12 a.m. it was, twelve. At 1 a.m. it was 5, 4, 1, and you go all the way down, and you know, so you can see, you can see the hierarchy. And if you don't want the whole, all the time, so what you can do is you can simply remove this, row, and you can say, okay, remove field, and it's going to go back to your, or the other thing you can do is, I still want to, like, you know, add the time. So let's say I want to have the checkout time here. I want to have the checkout time, but if you collapse it, so if you see this plus and minus button, so it's basically collapsing anything below that, the hierarchy. So if I don't want the times, I just want the date, so I can press the minus button and it's going to collapse, but it's only going to collapse for that day. So if you want to collapse it for every day, you can come here and you can say expand collapse, and you say collapse entire field. So now it's going to collapse for all the days. And if you want to expand it for all the days, you go here, you say expand collapse, and you say expand entire field. And it's going to do the entire field, right? So that's a, you know, just like how you want to view things. So you come here and you collapse or add entire fields. And so you're just doing more analysis on this. So let's say you want to find out, okay, how many minutes the bikes were checked out for. So trip duration minutes, right? And you want to find out some of those, right? So by default, Excel will find the most common thing that you want, right? If it's numbers, it's mostly going to go for some. If it's some, like, you know, text or other thing, it's going to pick some other default value. So in this case, you want the sums, right? You don't want the count. So it has already picked up some. Or you want, let's say, average trip time on a day, right? So you can come here and you can say average. This is your average. Or you want maybe the maximum time, so the longest trip on that day. So you can say maximum. That's going to give you the maximum for that. Right. Does this look right? This doesn't look right because, like, the maximum doesn't go that high. Let's see what's happening here. So the minimum is fine, but the maximum doesn't look like fine. And you can also do, like, sanity checks. So, you know, like, if you come here and it's giving you the maximum right here, so immediately I feel like, you know, 1509 minutes or 3193 minutes, that's like, what, like more than a day or something? Yeah, right. So this doesn't seem right. So what you can do is you can go to your data, and you've already selected here your filters, right? So if you go to trip, this is the column for trip duration minute, and this is where it's picking the numbers from, right? So you can go here and you can see here, and you can see a bunch of different distinct unique trip minutes values. So if you go scroll all the way down, you come here and you see that there is a number of 3193, right? So I don't know what happened, but like someone checked it out for like 2 days and never returned the bike, or like returned it after like, I don't know, 60 into 12, what's like that? 605 days? They like checked it out for 5 days. Maybe they didn't check it back, and they just like left the bike right somewhere, right? So you can do a sanity check. Like, you know, you can come here and you can say, okay, there is a number in this data which the pivot table is picking up. And so, you know, like this is like double checking. So the maximum was, 3193. And this is also like, you know, if you're doing an analysis, you can say, okay, you know, like on this seventh, like someone like picked out and it was a wild number. And this also like gives you, if you want to do analysis and you say like, what was the longest someone checked it out for? And you say, okay, like 3193 minutes, that's like 5 days. What was happening there, right? And similarly, you can do minimum, and in that case, you'll get the minimum, which is 2 minutes, which is like the minimum, you know, your trip duration, and that's for every day. So, you know, someone like every day, someone like checked out a bike for like, you know, just 2 minutes, like just checking it in, and then, you know, probably just returning it back on the same station or whatever. So that's the other thing with pivot tables. What else you can do? Let's see. So there's also membership and pass type. So you can see that how are they, you know, what is the distribution by membership or pass type? So you can put the membership and pass type here, and let's say I wanna, for now, let's say I want to remove checkout date and checkout time. So now we only have membership and pass type. So there's like 3 day weekender, explorer, local 31, local 365, pay as you ride, and student membership. So here you can like, you know, say, okay, the most rides have been in with student membership, like 6,000 compared to, you know, like others. And you can also say, okay, what is the, let's say I want like average duration of the trips for each membership type. So like how many, what is the average time a student checks out a bike for? What is the average time an explorer? So this is neat. Like, you know, student, it has like 11 minutes, right? That's like, and then Explorer has the highest average. And that makes like intuitive sense, right? You know, if someone wants to explore on bike, they're checking out for a long time, right? So they have the highest time, right? And students have the smallest time. They just want to, you know, they get checking it out in UT campus, going from one class to another. So like a small distances, right? Excuse me. So that is the other thing that you can do. And then so you can then add, okay, you want a more fine-grained analysis. So you want to do like checkout date for membership type. So for every membership type, there are dates. So the weekender, 3 day weekender, obviously it's only appearing on the weekend. So if you go to your calendar and you go to March, when was the weekend? That's interesting. The weekend was not from 11 to 14. It was actually from 7 to 10. I don't know what's happening. Like there's something wrong in the data. That's also like, you know, something that you can, if it's appearing in your data, if you're saying like 3 day weekender, people are checking out, like buying that pass over like weekdays, what's happening here? Like there's something wrong with the data, right? Or I don't know, like something's happening. So that's also like good ways to, you know, do some analysis. And so for and then you can, you know, get like fine grain analysis of each, you know, like each category. So I think let's try to. So you can also put in charts here. So yeah, so you can also put like chart here. So like, you know, you select all the data and actually let me show it to you again. So you can select all the data and you can say, okay, give me a insert here and give me a graph. And so I'm having a bar graph here. So what I'm doing here is like this is I'm just doing like average trip of duration minutes. So you can change the values from here. So you know, like you had average trip duration, but I want, let's say, I want the count, right? I don't want the average trip duration. So I'm just going to remove the trip duration, and I'm going to say that I want the count of this. So now in your graph, it has picked it up. It has picked it up and say, okay, it's giving you the count of your graph, right? You can also like put in filters here. So let's say if you want membership or pass type, you don't want 3 day weekender. So you're going to remove that. So it's going to remove the so it's going to apply the filter here, and it's going to remove that and see like how it's changing the data here in the pivot table also. So whatever you're doing in the graph, it's making the changes there also. And also you can say, okay, I don't want the checkout date, I don't want to include 3/5 or 3/6, these first 2 days. We're going to filter out those dates, right? So this is like a neat way of, you know, like doing seeing your results visually also. And so whatever you add here is going to add to your graph or chart also. And the other thing that you can do is so you have here, you can if you want to apply filter, so let's say I want to also have the checkout date, right? and entire field. So I have these checkout dates here, right? And let's say I don't want to. So it's sorry, wait. So I want to put a filter on these checkout dates. So what you can do is you can drag this checkout date to filters, and it's going to give you a filter up here, right? And now you can select whatever checkout dates you want to include. So if you want to do all if you want to include all checkout dates, you can pick it up from a filter here, right? And it's going to give you all of them. And if you just want, like, let's say for three, so if you just had wanted for like 3, 5, it's going to give you the results here. But right now, checkout date is in the filter, but you can also put checkout date in your rows. In this case, it will, build that hierarchy. So, oh, wait, why isn't it letting me? That's interesting. I think it did let you. Okay, so it's not letting me put it in both. Like, I think that's something you cannot do. So you can either put it as a filter at the top, and it's not going to be a row, but it's going to be a filter. So this is a good option if you're building like pivot tables to show someone, like, if you want someone to interact with that pivot table so they can apply the filters themselves. So you can put it as a filter, or you can put it as a row and apply a filter on it. So you see here this filter sign. So you go here and you say, okay, you drop and you say, okay, I want filters. So I just want 3, 3, 5. So now it's only going to give you 3, 5. You can also apply, like, value filters. And you can say, okay, I only want values which are greater than, or which are less than, or which are, in this. I don't know, like, if how I would apply that on a date. So this was count of trip ID, right? So let's say if I, yeah, so this is what I can do. Let's say I come here and do trip duration minutes. And okay, and then I come here and I say value filter and greater than. And I say, actually, let's go and say, okay, so these were your average values, right? And you come here and you say, okay, value filters, and I want only where average is greater than 15 minutes. Why isn't it applying that? That's so weird. Yes. And now, That's so weird. It's not doing that. But you can apply value filters. I'm not sure why isn't it doing that. I'll check this and get back to you. I don't know why isn't it applying the filter? But you can also apply filters by value. Okay, I just want the value which are greater than something or which are less than something. And I think it might be worthwhile to show you here. So if you go here and you say number filters and you say, okay, I just want all the values which are greater than like let's say 500 minutes, which is like a very large number. So I just want to see all those trips, right? So or actually like greater than actually. So there are just four trips here. So you can say, okay, which four trips were these? Okay, and what happened in those four trips? Where were these bikes checked out from? And where were they returned? And at what time were they checked out? And you know, at what time were they checked in? So, you know, it gives you, okay, so you found some anomalous, you know, like trips, and you say, like, these were more than 1,000 minutes. What was happening here? And, you know, like the trip ID, what were the members type? What were the bicycle type? You know, bike type. So you could, you know, you can do some analysis. You can find out, dig deep into the data. So you can apply the number filter here or you know like so and if you want to clear the filter you can just say clear filter here and it's going to bring you back to all the anywhere else where you can apply. Yeah, I think you can probably apply the filter here, or I think on the checkout date, you can say, okay, you can say date filters and you can say after and you can go here and it was your, you know, like it was in March. So you can say I only want after 8 March. And so it's going to give you all the dates after 8 March in the data. So there's this, you know, you can also apply filters from there. So I think that's I think we also have time, and I think that's enough for today. If you I'm sorry I never asked you guys for any questions. But if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer. Like if something didn't make sense. I'm also recording it, so I'm gonna upload the recording. Because a few people couldn't attend it and they asked me for a recording, so it will be online also. And if you have any questions, happy to answer them right now. And I know like you guys needed help with something else, so of the paper practice, so I can help you with that. But if you have any questions related to this, go ahead. Anything that didn't make sense, or some other feature on Excel. Obviously, we're gonna do this every alternate week. I'm gonna tell you the schedule for the next lab session. It might be next week, but I'm not sure about that yet. And it's going to get like, you know, more advanced because I know like Kate stopped at pivot tables, but there's a bunch of other stuff that you can do with Excel, like, you know, and I think in your on this Monday, I'm going to be doing the in-class practice. And you're going to see a bunch of functions which are complicated. So I already have like a recording for that online. Also, I'm going to do it in class, and then in the lab session I'll cover. So it's like VLOOKUP formulas and you know which are very like you know useful and important. So in the lab sessions I'm going to build upon Excel because I know like Kate's shifting towards R. That's also like that's an excellent resource if you know if you're interested in statistical analysis. And quantitative R is a great language for that. So I would highly recommend attending her sessions. And I will try to align my lab sessions with her. So, right after her session, I'll do my sessions. But my sessions would be on Excel, unless there's like a very specific demand with from majority of the class on a like specific software like R or Python, then I can think about that. But it would mostly be in Excel because our course covers Excel and all our assignments would be on Excel. So yeah, that was it for the lab session today. If you have any questions.